Our reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you would say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your servant, who has just come in from plowing or tending the sheep in the field, 'Come here immediately and take your place at table'? Would he not rather say to him, 'Prepare something for me to eat. Put on your apron and wait on me while I eat and drink. You may eat and drink when I am finished.' He is grateful to that servant because he did what was commanded. So should it be with you. When you have done all you have been commanded, say, 'We are unprofitable servants. We have done what we were obliged to do.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Glory to Jesus Christ, glory to him forever. Father Francis with you on this 27th Sunday in Ordinary Time. So, a few details that I want to maybe talk about as I begin this video, which probably may or may not have a whole lot to do with the gospel reading today or the readings in general, but I think I can kind of maybe refract them through the readings that I think will make a little bit of sense. First of all, as you know, I make these videos a few weeks in advance, and so right now as I'm standing here, we're right in the middle of some kind of desperate wildfires that are burning and kind of out of control at the recording of this video. The mosquito fire, kind of aptly a name with mosquitoes flying around me, mosquito fire is kind of burning out of control at this point in time, threatening Forest Hill and other places near there. So we certainly keep our prayers tuned for God's intervention to hopefully bring cooler temperatures, maybe some autumnal rains to kind of quell and maybe temper these wildfires. But the other thing that I think I need to mention in passing, historically, today is the 9th of September, and yesterday the 8th, the world said adieu, goodbye, farewell, to Queen Elizabeth II, who was the reigning monarch of the UK for over 70 years. And there was not a time in my life that I did not know about Queen Elizabeth. I believe she was coronated in 1953. And so I was born in 1956. So she has been the reigning sovereign of the UK ever since my existence. So. And in some ways, I kind of wanted to do just a little bit of a tribute and a little reflection on Queen Elizabeth and on monarchy in general. Queen Elizabeth certainly embodied the attitude that we do see reflected in our gospel today, knowing that, you know, we do the best that we can. You know, we take the faith as best as we are able to incorporate that and live it out. And certainly, Queen Elizabeth II did, I think, in many ways, was a very faithful woman and Christian. Now, it's true later in years, sometimes people kind of get a little bit soft and maybe acquiesce to certain things. And she apparently kind of caved in on a couple of Christianity's harder lines in order to be maybe a more of a softer sovereign. But I'm not gonna judge her on that. But again, the final words of our gospel today, you know, at the end we must realize that we are unprofitable servants. You know, we've done all that is expected of us. So for us to look around and for that pat on the back or that humility award or whatever it is that we're looking for, that recognition, that really wasn't what Queen Elizabeth, I don't think, was really all about. Now, it is true that the royal family was fraught with scandal after scandal. You know, whether it was Princess Margaret, her sister, with all of her kind of dalliances, you know, with Major Townsend, I guess, was the first one, you know, and again, having kind of an affair with a married man, whether it was, you know, Prince Edward or David, who had to abdicate the throne to Bertie, his brother, King George VI, because of his dalliance with the divorcee Mrs. Simpson, you know, whether it was all of the scandals revolving Diana, and of course there was Fergie, who can forget Fergie, and now Prince Andrew, unfortunately, who has been pretty much scandalized by his friendship with the late what's his name, you know, it's on the tip of my tongue, Jeffrey Epstein. So, you know, scandals galore, you know, scandal upon scandal upon scandal. But the personal life of Queen Elizabeth seems to have been spared any type of, you know, real scandal. I think the only thing that came close to her finding a little bit of disfavor with the British people was when Diana did die, and she was seemed a little too stoical and not coming forth and kind of, you know, honoring Diana. But that's another story for another time. In fact, Diana, if those of you who are pretty well versed in your current history, died the same week as Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And I always felt that Diana, who was a very self-absorbed, a very victimized. Now, again, to be sure, Charles, you know, I'm going to talk about this in a moment. Charles was carrying on, you know, this affair with another married woman, and that was completely wrong. But Princess Diana, unfortunately, they made her out to be a quote unquote saint, and she really was pretty far from being a saint. She might have been a good person in some ways, but the bottom line is that a real saint that week died. And Diana's death kind of eclipsed, you know, Mother Teresa's death. Now, of course, Mother Teresa, being a good servant, probably would have just said, hey, you know, hey, doesn't matter to me, you know, well done, good and faithful servant, you know, and I've done all that I've been obliged to do. And so, you know, we are, in the end, unprofitable servants. You know, again, the glory goes to Jesus Christ, not to us. So, you know, when you think about monarchy, and of course, our country fought a war to rid ourselves of monarchy, I think that there's some good things about monarchy, and there's some bad things, obviously, about monarchy. The problem, I kind of looked at monarchy as kind of like nuclear energy. You know, when it's right, it's really, really good. But the problem is when it's bad, it's really, really bad. And that's the problem. Now, you know, again, you have good monarchs, but for most part of history, we kind of realize that those good monarchs were very few and far between. And so one bad monarch could make a whole nation absolutely miserable, you know. So, and there's unfortunately too many examples of that in history to prove that fact. So it's sort of like, you know, yes, nuclear energy can be a very good thing, but it only takes one nuclear accident to really mess it up for the whole thing. You know, it's one nuclear accident is a horrible, horrible accident, and you'll pay for that for, you know, thousands of years. So, you know, monarchy is kind of in the same ballpark, I think. You know, if you have a really good monarch, that's great. But unfortunately, all too often we had horrible monarchs, and that's why we decided we went with the form of government that we did. Again, monarchy, you know, when it's all good and right, is perfect. Now, one of the things that I think a lot of Christians, and especially Catholics, kind of lose sight of is that in some ways, we do live in a monarchy under Christ the Sovereign King, and we'll be celebrating that feast day very soon, you know, in just a matter of weeks. We conclude our liturgical year with Christ the Sovereign King. And in many ways, we kind of don't appreciate that understanding of monarchy. And monarchy is, again, in and of itself, it's not a bad thing. But unfortunately, because of human hubris and arrogance and pride and concupiscence of human beings, it easily gets very easily corrupted. But under Christ the King, it is perfect. It is a perfect monarchy, and that's why we can, in other words, look at the good qualities of a good monarch. And Jesus, of course, is the perfect monarch. In fact, I don't know if there's something in the coronation rite, the British coronation rite, but something to the along the lines that the earthly monarch recognizes that they're really only governing instead of that this is a privilege that comes to them from Christ the King. And there's I don't have the exact words, but somehow they recognize that one day they will relinquish this throne, this rule back to the true monarch, which is Christ the King. So again, don't ask me where in the coronation rite that is, but I believe I've read that at one time, and I thought, wow, that's powerful. That's really wonderful that at least there is that understanding, that intellectual understanding, and they may not have truly understood or embraced it, but I think Queen Elizabeth certainly did do that, realizing that, okay, God has appointed me in this time and space temporarily to rule over or look over and these people. In other words, it's a responsibility, not a great privilege. I mean, it's a privilege too. But again, I think she was a wonderful example of that, being a good monarch. I mean, she was very rare. In fact, and I am kind of trying to dovetail this all into the readings today, but I have to say that I put it to the acid test today. One of my confreres visited, and I won't mention his name, but he's definitely of the Irish, the Fenian position, culture. And I asked him, I said, what are your thoughts of the passing of Queen Elizabeth? And I've had some Irish guys who are very, very, very outspoken, and they're very bitter of what England did to Ireland in many, many centuries ago. And he said, well, you know, I gotta be honest, she was not a bad woman. And he said, the thing is that she tried to do a lot of good things. And he said, she actually came to Ireland, and he remembered her apologizing for some of the things that England had done to Ireland in the past. And he said that for him was enough, you know, to say, yeah, I think she was a good lady. So, and again, I think when we do look at the readings today, you know, Jesus is talking about this faith that the disciples say, help increase our faith. And so, you know, the parable is kind of an interesting one because it kind of hinges on two different thoughts in some ways. Certainly there's the thought of, you know, we are unprofitable servants. You know, don't be looking for, you know, a pat on the back every time you do something good. You know, I'm afraid that in our world today, especially in our culture, our American culture, everybody's looking for, you know, participation trophies. You know, well, what about my contribution? You know, how come you're not acknowledging me? And sometimes, literally, you just do what's right, and you move on. You're not looking around for an appreciation award. Like, oh, what about me? You know, it's not about you. It's not about me. And so, you know, and in fact, I think that's what Queen Elizabeth kind of embodied is you do your duty. You do your duty regardless. And that's a great example that we should all try to have, because I think in today's day and age, everybody's kind of looking for that pat on the back. They're looking for that appreciation trophy. And, you know, that gets a little boring, to be honest with you. It gets a little tiresome, you know. You just do what's right. You don't have to do it because you're going to get acknowledged or get an award or get a certificate or get mentioned, you know, get your name in print, you know. You just do it because it's the right thing to do. But there's another element of this gospel, which is as I was reading it, it kind of dawned on me. And that is, you know, Jesus is talking about this great gift of faith. And he says, hey, you know, and in the beginning, he says, if you told this mulberry tree to be uprooted and planted in the sea, if you had real faith, it would do that. Now, that's an incredible thing, you know, very, very much so. But And then that first part of that parable that he talks about, you know, the servant coming in from the field, or the master coming in from the field, and, you know, and saying how ludicrous it would be for the servant to kind of say, well, you know, I'm going to sit down and you serve me, you know, master. Well, no. But I think what the point is that faith should be something that we command. We have a sense of, a proper sense of, you know, we exercise that faith. We say, okay, in faith I'm going to, you know, pray and believe that, you know, God's going to do this good thing, you know. And again, it's not like you're rubbing a magic lamp and, you know, praying for a Lexus, you know, or a new Tesla. I guess Lexus, those cars are kind of, they had their day. Now it's a Tesla. Yeah. So I'm going to pray real hard that God gives me a Tesla. Okay. Well, that's not what it's about, but it is about the fact that faith is kind of like a tool, you know, it's a powerful tool. And very far, you know, we're told that the word of faith is as close as the word in your mouth. In other words, it can be spoken, you know. And now again, I'm not talking about, you know, there's a kind of a group of Christians who believe you speak things into existence. I don't know if I'm going that far, but again, you know, we are called to speak the words of Christ. We're supposed to speak the word of God. You know, we proclaim that. You know, so. Again, I think that, you know, the analogy is that faith is a tool. It's something that we wield, if you will, in a positive way. You know, so again, it's not like you're calling down fire and brimstone on your opponents, but it means that you exercise, and this is a great power, and power in a good sense. Power can be a good thing, just like, you know, you can have power, you know, going back to the nuclear reactor thing, you can have nuclear energy that lights up cities and brings electricity to thousands, if not tens of thousands of people. That's a good thing, right? But nuclear energy can also be used in a destructive way. So again, but what I guess I'm trying to make the point is that faith is a powerful force, and it's a powerful force for good if we exercise it, if we have that right balance, you know, commanding those good things, you know. I believe, you know, that's what the creed is all about. You know, I believe, you know, credo in unum Deum, you know, you're proclaiming what you believe. You're proclaiming that faith. So, but anyway, in light of the passing of Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II, you know, we prayed for her this morning, certainly. And we, you know, well, I'll share my little commentary, and if you choose, you can choose to disagree if you want to. But I have to say honestly, because I grew up, I was a young man when Charles was going through all of his shenanigans, and I personally feel that when you look back on history and Edward, he had to abdicate the throne because he was going to marry this woman who was a divorcee, and I really feel that Charles, I think he should do the right thing. And the right thing would be for him, and plus he's 70 years old, maybe older. He's older than I am. He doesn't have many years left. Anyway, I think it would be the right thing for him to do is just quietly abdicate and give the monarchy, hand that over to William, the firstborn. And because, you know, Queen Elizabeth was 25 when she was coronated, and I think William's probably 30, in his early 30s, so he's still young enough to where, you know, it would be, I think, appropriate. Charles, I have to say, I don't think is suitable for lots of reasons. Partly because of his dalliances with Camilla. He was, you know, having an affair when he was married to Diana. And again, I'm not a big Diana fan, but I think that, you know, he was not a good man. If he had just made the choice. Well, of course, he couldn't have married Camilla anyway because she was already married before that. So it was just a bad thing. Double entendre type thing. Not double entendre, but double indemnity kind of thing. It was bad for so many reasons. And so if he's going to be unfaithful in his marriage. Now, if he had not married Camilla and he had kind of shown that he had kind of repented of that, then I'd say, okay, all right, maybe. You know, and he was kind of living a single life, a celibate life. I'd say, okay, I'm willing to give the guy a benefit of the doubt and give him a second chance. But, you know, he kind of did the Frank Sinatra. I'm going to do it my way. So I think he's unsuitable. Plus, I think he's kind of proved himself to be a little bit imbecilic, I think. He kind of is a goofy guy. He's not right up there, I think. I don't know. That's my personal opinion. So I really think that it would be more suitable and better if Charles would quietly just give the throne to William and just step aside. I think that would be the most noble thing that he could do. And I think it would be the best thing for the British monarchy. If Charles insists on being Charles III, I predict, and this is just my own humble prediction, that it probably might be the beginning of the end of the British monarchy. Because, you know, they were talking to some regular people, young people, and for the most part, it was like, they're not buying it, you know. And, you know, Charles has kind of burned his bridges. And I just think that the best thing to do for the monarchy, the British people, the UK in general, would just be for him to quietly just hand that, you know, just acquiesce and give that throne, hand the monarchy to William and Kate. I think that would do a world of good right now. But time will tell. But again, in the end, all of us, whether it's Prince Charles or Queen Elizabeth II, or you and me, we have to remember at the end of the day, we must consider ourselves as unprofitable servants. Well, I hope you got something out of that this day. May God bless you today and every day. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.